beautiful, peaceful scene. Marvellous when you look around. In fact, this scene here, this place, is one of the most favoured fishing spots of this whole area. And people come here all the time, just to fish. Big barramundi. And where I am, I'm just on the edge of Kakadu National Park. In fact, this road, if I went any further, I'd be going into Aboriginal Arnhem Land. And when you look around, it looks so peaceful, you'd almost be tempted to have a swim. But I wouldn't do that, because here I consider one of the most dangerous areas in the country, because this is Carl's Crossing on the East Alligator River.
Also getting bigger, and he's no longer frightened of us. His world is the waters of the tropics of Australia. If he hasn't caused havoc at this stage, it's simply because there are not many people on the northern rivers and the coast of this part of Australia. But that's all changing, because more and more people are coming into his habitat, and there are more and more crocodiles, and they're bigger. Now, it's been illegal to shoot them since 1971, because that's when they were protected. Man and reptile are having to share the same waters of the north, and there are places where it's getting quite crowded, like the top end of the Northern Territory in the dry season. One of the hot spots is Carl's Crossing on the East Alligator River, where there has already been one fatal attack. I had to start somewhere, and to me, this is the very place to start. And by the way, the name Alligator isn't a mistake. This river was named after one of the early British ships. I was lucky. I've just run into one of the National Park's rangers. Now, he set up a crocodile trap less than 100 metres from the crossing. Now, the idea of this is they have a crocodile here that's causing them worry. They're trying to catch it. When they do catch him, they'll send it to one of the crocodile farms.
Really, why have we set this trap here to try and get this specific crocodile? What's the reason?
Well, the main reason is that we have, if you like, a manual procedure where we identify animals on this river system, right, and we can designate, if you like, a nuisance crocodile.
Right.
And a nuisance crocodile is one that is exhibiting actions that could potentially be hazardous to people.
Unusual behaviour.
That's right. Yeah. And this particular animal, the one we're after here, has shown no fear of boats, no fear of people. And where we are here, he's on each rising tide, he's normally up around here and just hanging off the boat ramp. Yeah.
We didn't have to wait long to see our first croc, because somebody yelled out there's a 6-footer laying on the bank just a couple of hundred yards up the other side of the crossing. He wasn't a big one, but he's a bit bigger than 6 feet, probably nearer 8. And really, he wasn't scared of us. He let us come within about 15 feet. The water here at the crossing is tidal. In fact, it's low tide now. But when this chap was taken recently, it was almost high tide. There was a few feet over the crossing.
The incident took place on the crossing here. Water levels are a lot greater than they are now. There's a lot of fresh water coming down from the wet season. high tide, the chap was on the crossing and then was either swept off or fell off, and a crocodile attacked him downstream of the crossing just over here.
Just on this other side?
Yeah.
That's between here and your trap?
That's right, yeah. So, you know, he'd just been walking across to talk to some people on the other side and he was coming back.
And he was coming back from talking to the people?
Yeah.
Hell, that'd have been a hell of a shock to them. Did nobody see the croc? Did they, you know, do anything?
By all accounts, yeah, they did. They did indicate that there's a large crocodile in the air and shouted to him, but...
We got an air trim, probably.
Yeah, apparently he didn't hear, but... So that was the basic story that we've got, because we were in the water within 10 minutes and we covered the remains.
The whole of this north of Australia is a great place for people to enjoy themselves. They can go fishing or boating or just go out into the bush for the weekend. But we've got to remember that this country is the home of the crocodile.
Crocodile fatalities and attacks. A policeman, second mate, an Aboriginal boy, a Malaysian man, Aboriginal woman, a young woman. These notes were supplied to me by the Conservation Commission, and as I looked through them, one of the things that had occurred to me was that the crocodile doesn't discriminate. Doesn't matter whether you're black or white or a Malaysian or an Australian. They're all the same. In fact, do you know that in the last 10 years there has been over 10 people attacked with crocodiles? And it's going to get worse, a lot worse, because today they're protected. And they're getting bigger and bigger all the time. And they have no fear of humans. A few years ago, when I first came up here, a crocodile would see you and disappear into the water. He was timid. Not today. They'll swim alongside the boat. So all the ingredients are there for more attacks. There has got to be. Because once you mix together human beings and crocodiles, the human is in a non-win situation.
This is St. Mary's Cathedral in Darwin. What does that have to do with crocodiles, you may ask? Well, believe me, St. Mary's Cathedral has a lot to do with the Northern Territory. For a start, it's built out of all local stone. Second, it has a black woman in one of the mosaics in the Stations of the Cross. And also, there's a magnificent painting of a black Madonna and child. But besides this, there is something else. This is what I've brought you in to show you. These two stools plus the chair. Now the stools are called sedilias. And this is the bishop's chair or throne. Now today it is lined with vinyl. But when it was put in many years ago, the bishop insisted that it was upholstered in crocodile skin. And it was. And it was magnificent. But after a few years, it then cracked because it hadn't been prepared properly. And afterwards, they got rid of it, put vinyl on, which was a shame. But what I'd like to do now is take you and show you where they got the crocodile that the skin for the upholstery of this chair came from. I think you'll find it interesting. This is the Sacred Heart Mission on the beautiful Daly River. Now it's situated about 150 kilometres southwest of Darwin as the crow flies. Now it's a huge place, very neat and tidy, and very well run, as are all the Catholic missions up in this area. And meet Father Corrie, the parish priest. He goes back to the 1950s, and he is going to tell me the story of the cathedral crocodile.
And there, down in the river, was this big crocodile
swimming
up the river with its snout quite out of the water. See it quite clearly, its head. We knew it was a big one. Now, in those days, we had a different attitude to a situation like that. The attitude was that once the crocodile poked his head up, it should be shot. Yes, well, that was John O'Brien, an Australian...
Before I can pass on the story of the cathedral crocodile, Father Corrie wants to show me the site of the first mission built here on the other side of the Daly River. Now, this was built in 1886, and it was a Jesuit mission.
This one here, built at the same time as down there, at the Jesuit monastery. His father was the local postmaster, and he did his studies to be a Jesuit there, and eventually ended up here on the Daly.
Yeah, marvellous, isn't it?
And a tremendous, it's a great achievement.
1886 to 1986, to commemorate the centenary of the first Jesuit Mission Foundation, Holy Rosary Station.
Really, there's not much here to show what life would have been like in those days. But believe me, they would have had it very tough. In a letter dated 1897, the superior of the mission actually wrote, "Another of the school children was eaten by a crocodile within 100 yards of the house. He went some feet into the river, as the blacks often do, and stooped to drink, when his life was snapped from him by the terrible jaws of the reptile. The child did not even scream. The crocodile was an old offender, and the blacks knew him well." But now to the story of the cathedral crocodile. I've told you a lot of stories, but this one has a very interesting twist. And really, it's Father Corrie's story. And why I've got him here, I might need him to correct me. It concerns an Aboriginal hunter called Whack and his family.
What had happened, they'd shifted camp to a new area, and all of a sudden, one of his wives or that said, "Quick, big crocodile in the river." Well, his business was shooting crocodiles, so they downed tools and got in a canoe and tore into the river. And the idea was that the front man would shoot the crocodile, and the chap sitting in the back, he would put a harpoon in it so you didn't lose it, because it was in the middle of the river, it'd go to the bottom. So he shot it all right, but the chap at the back didn't get the harpoon into it. So they'd more or less lost it. So they'd go back and do what they had to do with the camp, come back afterwards and see if they could get this big croc. No sooner did they get back and started their work, and one of the wives again said, "Quick, another big croc." And here was another croc swimming along, equally as big as the other one, head out the water. So they back into the canoe again and out there. And before they can get organised again, this other big croc did a couple of circles and dived down and comes up with the other crocodile in its mouth. And so then they get alongside and they shoot this one, get the harpoon into it, and really they'd got the two of them, as amazing as it seems, got the two of them. And Father Corrie, when Whack was telling him this story, said, "Whack, that's very hard to believe that could happen, that that big croc was going to eat that other croc, because I thought they only ate meat that had decayed and so and so." And he looked at Father in an astounded way and said, "Father, him not going to eat him, that's his missus."
The Daly in its time was one of the top crocodile areas of the Northern Territory. Today, it's the top recreational river up here. Not far from Darwin, miles of clean water, good fishing, good boating, and lots of people come here in the weekends. Now, unlike the East Alligator River and a lot of the other rivers of the north, it is still considered safe. Safe, that is, from crocodiles.
If it remains like this, it would be marvellous. But is it going to remain like it? Because when I think of all this top end part, it's, say, very similar to Africa, where you have a giant game park. But it's fenced off. You've got to go inside the fence, really,
to see the animals. And so when you come up here, really, you are in one giant park with no fences. A little bit different. But they say that this is still safe, and I accept that. You know, I'm here at the water's edge fishing. Now, there's no way would I do that up, say, on the East Alligator or the South Alligator River. That's too dangerous. But here, I go with the mob and I accept it. I hope they're right, because if they're not, I'm going to get one hell of a shock.
Aborigines lived with crocodiles for thousands of years. In a sense, they were neighbours. They had to learn to live with them. I believe that the Aborigines were so knowledgeable about the croc that really they would have had very little trouble with them. They could tell, for instance, if there was a big one around, just by the mudslides on the bank, or just by seeing them every day. Even so, there are records of attacks on Aborigines, but really, they were very few. The Aborigines were very important to the crocodile industry up here. For many years, they worked as offsiders for the white hunters. And of course, they did all the hard work, the skinning and the salting of the skins. And then after the war, when the boom prices came, a lot of them worked for themselves, shooting and skinning. In fact, Jimmy Parry and Jimmy Number Two for many years earned their living on the Daly River.
Not here. Yes. Up Rick, you know, we come
right. Right, you come here and then shift somewhere else.
Yeah. Shift another billabong.
Right. That's it. So you go from one billabong to another one all the time.
Yeah, another billabong with camp.
Okay, and where was your camp?
Here.
Well, what about the crocodiles in here?
No. And you can, easy, you can put them boat there.
You put your boat here?
Yeah. More easy, and they can come down there.
Right. And where am I going to get a barramundi here? Where?
That on there, look.
Just in there?
Where that banana is.
Right. Beautiful. Beautiful spot.
Yeah, good one, this one, for the country.
I just have a try here. You never know, might be one in here.
Go on.
Give me your weapon.
Might even got a big one there, huh?
Might get anything, I think.
The riverbank on the Daly River, just down from the mission, is littered with wrecks of old trucks that were once used to collect and transport crocodile skins.
You don't realise until you see these.
Roy Moffat remembers this place as a camp belonging to one of the skin buyers. Roy was a very experienced crocodile shooter. And as an ex-kangaroo shooter, I was very interested to listen to some of the stories of his experiences with the crocodiles.
With the big crocs, for instance, when I first went into the Baines River, the manager of the Verne asked me to go down there because they were only saving one foal out of three. You see, the big crocs are taking the foals. You know, crocodiles are territorial. One will live here, and then you might go down as far as, say, 600 metres down. There's another one living down there, big one, you know. And if they come up into one another's area, they fight. You quite often see those big ones with an arm missing and scars on them. Well, as soon as you come in, they've never seen the light. If they've never seen the light, the spotlight, they'll swim straight towards it. And then, of course, those big ones, the great big ones, then I shot them, you know. Well, I had to get rid of them. But if you missed him, if you just missed him, if you didn't wait until he got close enough to you, and per chance you missed him, that was it. You never got another chance of that fella. He, as soon as he sees the light, he'd look at you for a long way, he'd pull his head down, he'd look through one eye, and then he'd go down. So you never got a chance to see him a second chance. You just had to get him that first time.
The loss of another industry in 1971 was part of the old story along the Daly. The first mission in 1899 was one of the earliest failures. A lack of finance, reoccurring diseases and devastating floods all played their part.
Make a deal on, you know. And,
even the government experimental farm, which was established in 1908, lasted only a few years. After the First World War, men took up land along the river and tried to grow crop after crop, pumpkins, maize, peanuts, but pests and the climate and even the economics always beat them in the long run.
It that never occurred to me you'd have to do that. Of course you would, wouldn't you, to get the rubbish off.
Well, you couldn't, yeah, rubbish and tails or peanuts, you know.
Even the retired crocodile shooter gave up his farm after 5 years. He'd had enough. And he decided that he'd go crocodile shooting again, but this time in New Guinea.
Yes, I put it up in 1952.
The people that have done best here on the daily are the people that were here first. And the mission today is really a big town. And the people look so contented. Today, the farms along the beautiful river are still waiting for the boom time. Maybe this is it, mangoes. The first fruit from this orchard will be picked this year. That's if the flying foxes don't get them first. And really, that's not all that's new. One of the descendants of the early settlers, Glenis Taylor, has introduced some top quality goats. And this could be the beginning of a very profitable kind of dairy. Anyway, it's worth a try. And how about this one? Kahu catches tropical fish for aquariums all over the country, and he gets $2 each from. Now that's not bad money. But it's when you see the McLeods that you realise what the Daily River is all about. Relaxation and a very pleasant lifestyle. Alan and Norma McLeod retired from Darwin. To me, they retired to a Garden of Eden. It wouldn't be hard to doze off here and have a little kip. Beautiful area, the Daly River. Pandanus in the background, beautiful river. But I've got to get back to the story. Crocodiles, that's what I'm here about. And on the 30th of June 1971, the crocodile was finally protected. And they honoured this up here. I hardly know of one incident of a crocodile being shot since. But not long after this was the most unparalleled series of attacks in the history of crocodiles. And it was by one rogue crocodile in one specific area. I don't know whether that's the right word to use, rogue. You be the judge of that. But next, I'm going to tell you the story of this crocodile, Sweetheart. This stretch of water on the Finnis River was known as Sweet's Lookout, and it was the home of the crocodile Sweetheart. It was also the site of 13 attacks by that one crocodile over a period of 5 years. The attacks on the fishing parties began in 1974. Two men and a woman were fishing one evening. It was a very hot night, very humid, and very quiet. Suddenly the boat was rocked and the head of a huge croc appeared over the stern of the boat. The croc hit the boat again, then took hold of it and shook it. The woman was almost flung over the side. In their desperation, they got the small motor going,
But the croc then took hold of the motor, propeller and all in its mouth, and shook it. The monster lifted himself half into the boat, and of course water poured in. To the great relief of these people, the croc then disappeared. 12 months later, Sweetheart did the same thing to the same boat. This time, he broke off a piece of the engine cowling and put his teeth right through the hull. Almost exactly 12 months later to the day, a Northern Territory policeman, Ken Phillips, was fishing on this very billabong with his two sons and a friend. It was one of those hot, humid November days.
Well, we'd been fishing for around about an hour. And we're trawling along the bank. Nothing much was happening. It was all very quiet. And all of a sudden, there was an almighty clang on the boat, just as if you'd hit the bow of the boat with a sledgehammer. Then all of a sudden, the boat lurched to the right. And I thought we definitely were on a snag, and it rolled right over to one side. Merv was sort of stunned and amazed, and I looked at him, and he's actually, I suppose I was too, but he was white. And at that stage, on the left-hand side of the boat, the croc just surfaced, came up, and his head came up almost within touching distance of the boat. And I thought, it's Sweetheart. But I instinctively pointed my rod at the crocodile for some reason. I really don't know to this day why I did it. He went down, and we're all sort of still pretty shocked, but the thing that stuck in my mind was if I try and rev the motor up, that he might attack the motor. So I took off slowly. We went 20, 30, 40 metres without seeing the croc again, and really took off and left from there, and that was it.
The attacks continued right through until 1979. Such people as Max Curtin and Ian Watson, Clyde Rebourth, Max Davidson, Terry O'Brien, Carl Blumanis, and Dick Gleisner. All of these people were experienced Northern Territory bushmen and fishermen. 13 attacks in all. By May 1979, the Conservation Commission had decided that Sweetheart was becoming too dangerous. Whilst he had never attacked anybody or killed anybody, and considering all the people that he'd thrown out of the boats, he'd had plenty of opportunity. But they knew that it would only be a matter of time. Policeman Denver Marchant and Ranger Dave Lindner went hunting for him on Sweet's lookout on the night of the 28th of May 1979. Denver Marchant takes up the story.
This apparition appeared behind Dave, for want of a better word, because I knew what it was, but I didn't sort of want to believe what it was. And it headed straight for the top of the outboard motor for the cowling. And it hit the boat with a heck of a thump. The impact caused me to fall over backwards. And Dave got propelled off the seat, which is just here, onto his knees in front of me, because I went right over backwards. And in front of me, I had a fishing basket, a prawn basket, so to speak. And I had a 577 double rifle. Now, that was going to be the weapon I was going to use, but of course I was nowhere near it. And I fell over backwards. As I went over, I sort of grabbed the side of the boat, and I know I left crimp marks in it, and out of sheer panic and fright, I suppose. But I got back up on the seat again. What had happened, the transom had been pulled right under the water, and the water just poured over the back of it. It had a V transom. And Dave sat back up in the seat. We looked at each other, and because we knew what it was, obviously. But Dave hadn't seen it, of course, but I'd seen it right on Dave, and I had obviously had a wild look in my eye. I said, oh, that line out of, classic line out of Jaws. I said, we need a bigger boat.
Sweetheart survived that attempt, but the end was near. Traps and snares were set, and 1 month later, the king of the Finnis River was finally captured. He was meant to be taken alive, but in his prolonged struggle, Sweetheart drowned. Well, this is Sweetheart, the crocodile. And I'm in the Darwin Museum. And really, I would have much sooner
taken you, say, to the crocodile farm and shown you Sweetheart when he was alive. He's 5.1 metres in length. That's just over 16 and a half feet. And in excess of 800 kilograms in weight. And, I mean, when you look at him, have a look at the size of those back legs, the teeth. And he's a male. A lot of them reckon he was a female, because only a female could be that cantankerous. And when you think of all this and you look at him and you think how ferocious he looks and realise that he never ever killed anybody or attacked any person. Amazing. A long-term situation like the one with Sweetheart just could not happen in the north today, because at the first sign of a croc becoming a nuisance, the rangers are out setting traps or getting them with the harpoon. These are the rangers of the Northern Territory Conservation Commission. Now, they're out on their regular patrol of the Darwin Harbour because the Conservation Commission has decided, in their wisdom, that Darwin Harbour has to be crocodile-free. They will endeavour to capture any crocodile they see in the harbour. And really, they've captured hundreds. The crocs are caught by using a harpoon. Now, this has a little set of short barbs on the end, which is jabbed into the crocodile while he is laying on the surface being dazzled by the lights. Some problem crocs are just too old to catch at night by the harpoon. They're too wary of the light and the sound of the motor, and they're simply too big to put into the boat. Recently, the rangers had a call for help from the Victoria River, which is roughly 300 kilometres southwest of Darwin. Now, a big croc was taking livestock and was dangerously close to humans. For big crocs like this, of course, they set a trap. He was as big as Sweetheart, and he was still alive. Now, this was the largest croc taken alive by this method, but it was important to get him onto dry land quickly, otherwise he could drown. He weighed almost a ton, and his age was estimated at 70 years. Crocs nest in the wet season, piling up a mound of vegetation into which they lay approximately 50 eggs. The female guards the nest for approximately 3 months till the eggs hatch, and then she tries to look after the hatchlings for another couple of months. But despite this impressive protection, only about 1% survives, because they are easy prey for the fish and the birds of these waters. The conservation rangers rob the eggs from some of these nests simply to make sure more crocodiles survive. And in fact, this is very handy for research, and also if they want to replenish stocks in some areas. It's an expensive and difficult job, and there's always mum to worry about. Back to the Perosis on the Darwin Harbour, and the boys have harpooned a small one, perhaps 3 years old. The harpoon has been used to catch many crocs without causing any apparent damage or even discomfort. It doesn't seem to worry them.
We don't see many. You've been out with us tonight, and this, we haven't seen much more than this. They used to be much larger than this. Now we're getting reduced down to this type of animal. So there's been something like 400 taken out since 1980. And, you know, there's a lot of obvious success, in our opinion, anyway. He'll just stay in the boat overnight, and then tomorrow he'll go to one of the croc farms, and I'll scoot mark him. These scoots here, you've got single digits up this side, tens, and then hundreds, so he might be number 232. So you take those scutes out, and that's his mark for life. And in the croc farm, they won't grow again. So that's where he'll go.
If you're a young crocodile and don't mind lots of company, one of these farms wouldn't be a bad place. You'd have to like the taste of chickens, though. The people, they're just for looking at.
Now these again are saltwater crocodiles. These animals here are approximately 22 months of age. Now the first thing you'll notice, there's a great discrepancy in the different sizes for the relative age. The way that works is it's the same way as in the main lake. The bigger, bolder guys, when it's feed time, race in and grab as much as they can. The smaller guys hold back, therefore do not get as much, therefore do not grow as rapidly. So part of our work here is about every 6 months we go in here, sort them all out, get the smaller guys, put them in with animals their own size so they can compete equally on the terms of food and they can start growing rapidly again. And that's about 1 foot a year.
It's nice that they help the little ones catch up. It means that they'll be handbags a little earlier. I wonder if that's crossed their mind. I can agree on some terms of it. It's only the ones they catch in the wild that can live a long, happy life here. The ones that are bred here and born here are killed by the time they're 4 or 5 years old. It is, as they say, a farm. One thing you notice about these crocodiles, they're a bad-tempered lot. Every time this young bloke moves, they want to have a go at him. And he seems to have the same opinion of them as me. One thing you've got to understand
about a crocodile, a lot of people are fascinated by him, they want one as a pet. What you've got to realise, he will never, ever tame down.
Come on, get him. Come on.
You could have one of these guys from the day he's born having 15 years. 15 years in one day, he'll take your arm or your leg or whatever. He will never tame down. And if you think, if you want to let one go back in the wild after 15 years that he won't survive, he'll never look back twice. They rely on instinct to survive. Put one of these guys back in the river, he knows exactly what to do. He won't think about you twice. So they're not an ideal pet. And they have a very nasty temperament, like that. To give you an idea of the power these fellows have, when they latch onto you, we've got to prize it open with a pair of with a steel screwdriver, and then it's a trip off to the hospital to get sewn up again. So they're not an ideal pet. Very, very powerful animals. Now, with these guys here, part of the farming procedure is we feed these guys.
The day after the little ones are fed, their pens are drained, hosed out, and refilled. It's a very important hygiene practice. But they don't seem to like it. They don't seem to like anything, though.
Come in here, hose them all down, hose the drain out, pick all the stones, hose fittings and other paraphernalia that people love to throw at crocodiles for some reason.
I've never really noticed before the difference in colours between the different crocodiles. I don't think it means anything like a different breed or a different species. In fact, I suppose it's something like us humans, blondes or redheads or brunettes, whatever it may be. They call this fella here leopard. He's real yellow, isn't he? This is Bert. He's exactly the same size as Sweetheart. Bert sleeps it off. He's always asleep, they tell me. Lame doggo. Probably waiting for one of those tasty keepers to get a little bit closer. Ugly, isn't he? Only his mother could think he's beautiful. There are the scutes that ranger spoke about. But these are a bit bigger. The crocodile is really getting the tourists in. In fact, it's a whole new industry. But when you think of it, I'd expect this because he survived for millions of years. He's been one of the success stories in the animal world. Have thought such a lazy looking animal could be so agile, so alert, and really doing tricks. Used to be the buffalo that was promoted to the tourists, but this animal was here a long time before the buffalo. They're coming from all over Australia to have a look at him now. In fact, from all over the world, thanks probably to Paul Hogan. Sweetheart is the showpiece of the museum. People are always asking the staff, where do I see Sweetheart? Which way do I get to Sweetheart? Now, that's been quite a change around in 20 years, isn't it? But it's the other turnaround that's worrying me and worrying a lot of other people, because the crocodile has changed from being a wary animal to being very bold and aggressive.
Recently, people have told me that they're quite often that the crocodiles come up into and nudge their dinghies, and well, in my time, that never ever happened, because the big crocodiles were always frightened of man because of the sound of the shots.
Another thing that struck me is the locals' reaction to these crocodile attacks. Because I said to different ones of them, but what about the girl that was taken in Western Australia? Or what about the chap taken on the East Alligator River? Or the fisherman at Borroloola? And in every case, they said roughly the same thing. They knew there was crocodiles in that area. The fisherman was aware that it was crocodile country. Him probably more than anybody else, because he sees them every day. There's signs everywhere. And I come to realise that really all these territorians are on the crocodile side. Not everyone thinks about crocodiles like that. In fact, in North Queensland, when the woman was taken in the Dane Tree area, they really went berserk. They practically shot the whole river out. Now, I don't go along with that, but I think we've got to do a lot better than we are. For instance, that is dangerous. Now, I believe some fisherman is going to get taken by these semi-tame crocs. This practice is either got to be stopped, or this area has got to be made out of bounds for the tourists. There are some areas, such as the Daly River as an example, that should be ruled out of bounds for the crocodile. the conservationists, the rangers tell me that you can't do this because if you shoot one, another one will move in. And then you shoot that one, another one will move in. But as Roy Moffat has said, if you shoot them and continue to shoot them, they will avoid the area like the plague because they become very wary of it. Now, if this is not acceptable, then why not build a crocodile-proof fence around and make an area safe for swimming? Because if you are trying to entice people to an area, well then you have to guarantee them some degree of safety. Because if you don't do this, it's like putting the Christians in with the lions.
Over there.
You can swim here because you can see him over there.
It's driven, but they've got big ones.
The lions have arrived on the daily. They've been working their way up from the coast and they've finally reached here. They're now at the mission.
But wait a minute. If you couldn't see him over there, would you swim in there then?
No, he'd come straight to me.
Ah, so you, when you see him, it's all right?
Yeah. Then he dives in, you have to get out of the water.
Yeah. I wouldn't be going in there whether I could see him or whether I didn't.
A 12-footer has been seen above the crossing. They're now trying to catch him. This means that living on the daily is no different to living on any other river in the Northern Territory. You are living with crocodiles.
Oh, no, no. Oh, there's crocs all the time around here. Water crocs.
And every time you come down here, you bring a rifle?
My word, I do. I come down to start it, and I come down to turn it off and bring a rifle. Now, I look around here. Look along here. Yeah. There's none lying around. And I got, when I start this engine, I've got to turn me back, see, to the water.
Right.
Then I can't see.
Right.
When Kahu stands on the water's edge now, he has a good look for the big one because he's seen it near this very sandbar. And Glenys Taylor, well, she's not feeding as many of her goats as she used to.
The morning that my billy goat was taken, he was a pet. We reared him from 10 days old. We got him from Alice Springs. And he just wasn't here. And I went down and looked along the riverbank, but I looked the wrong side. And then my husband went down and looked along the riverbank the other way. And you could see the roll where the crocodile had been lying beside the log waiting for them. And he'd rolled them back into the river, pushed all the long grass down, going back into the river.
Right.
And later on that afternoon, there's crocodile cruising.
A lot of the people tell us along the river they're all losing dogs. Everybody seems to lose dogs. Yes. You know, I never realised they'd lose goats as well. See?
Well, they're a meal the same.
That's right, yes.
And I've got to turn me back there, put oil in it, petrol, check that.
This bloke's making me nervous now, but everyone living on this river is nervous now. And if they're not, they should be.
Start the motor and away she goes. I'll go back.
Right, I'll shift the motor and put it behind these two trees.
Oh.
Time has come again, the end of another film. And I feel a little sad in a way because I've really enjoyed making this film. Wonderful people, Father Corrie, the Aborigines, people I've met throughout the film.
couple of little things I would like to say. And one is, I honestly believe that if, say, the Tourist Commission or people that want us to come, the tourists, to these areas, then they must make a place like this crossing on the Daly River, say, safe for swimming and fishing. I believe that's a must. Also, throughout my films, I've given many tips on survival, how to survive in different situations. I'm going to give you what I think is a very, very important one. Whenever you go to rivers in this Northern Territory, into the top part of Australia, always pay that there's a crocodile in there. Now, why I'm saying to do this is, then you will not do the silly things, hands over the side in the water, feet dangling in the water, you standing up to your knees in water, cleaning your fish. That's only calling them in. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the film. Look, I'm going to now try and catch one of these very, very elusive barramundi. I think they're a myth, but I'm going to try.